Hi everyone, I am Chris from Simply Classic, and today we're going to continue with our oldie but goodie series of videos. Today we're going to do the Leotote. And the Leotote, I have a couple here completed, is a tote bag that has a nice surprise on the inside. That surprise is a separate section for a water bottle. The divider here for the water bottle section can hold up to a 40-ounce bottle of water. So you can get your big old water jug, fill it up, stick it right in there, and you are good to go for the day. It does have crossbody straps, and you can see here these are our strap connectors for the crossbody section. We have a pretty cool design here at the bottom. Of course, it does have feet. On the inside, we do have this zipper section. The zipper section does not go over the water bottle section, so you can easily grab that water bottle in and out. But when you open up the zipper section, you will see paper. Okay, you will see you have a great big section here for everything else that you typically carry. You've got a slip pocket on one side. On the other side, you have a zipper pocket. And then, of course, you have a key fob as well. Now, the thing I love about this is a lot of my customers have hacked this bag and made it into something for themselves. You know, I love that. A pattern is a suggestion, not a rule. You can do whatever you want with these patterns. This bag has been turned into a camera bag where instead of using Decoville Light, the customer used foam, put their lens down in here, put the camera in the other section. I think she extended the zipper section to zipper it all the way, and then she had an amazing camera bag. You would not know that this is a camera bag, right? It looks like a purse. I mean, it's amazing. I've had people turn it into gym bags where they put their towel on this side and then all their gym clothes on the other side. What an amazing gym bag that would be. I've had people leave the water bottle divider out and just extended the zipper section and made it a great big huge tote bag. They put their computer, their iPad, all kinds of neat stuff in there, whatever they need to carry. Had people put pockets on the outside in between the strap connectors. So my point is this bag is very versatile. You make it how you want it or your customer wants it, make it your own. Do it with the piping, without the piping, however you please. So this one here is, of course, with some faux leather. We have a leather version here, and we do have kits available for the leather version. It is just so soft and is so beautiful. When you touch this leather, it's amazing. What I liked about the leather is that it's actually has a little pattern and texture to it. I don't know if you can be able to see that. Maybe if you don't see me, it'll focus. Maybe not. Anyway, it's got like a little, almost like a lizard texture on it. It's so pretty. Just gives it a little bit of extra something. Okay. So today I have taken the liberty to do a few things already. We'll go over what those are. We are going to quilt our bag. So I'm going to show you how to get the quilt pattern onto the bag. We are going to pretty much, once the bag's quilted, pretty much put it together. I've got everything else completed. So we'll refer you back to the original video, the original tutorial, if you want step-by-step instructions on how to do this bag. We're going to concentrate on the piping and the lining because the lining is made a little bit differently than other bags you've seen. Okay? So we're going to go ahead, get to the machine, and get started. First thing you want to do whenever you start quilting is put a fresh bobbin in because you will need it. You will go through the thread pretty quickly. So I have a brand new bobbin in. I have already done a few things. I have already made my interior zipper pocket. I put the zipper on and of course, you know, the zipper pull, and this is going to be ready to go. So that is completed. The interior slip pocket is completed. I have my key fob completed. I also have my two handles completed. Okay, those are sewn, ready to go. I have the crossbody strap completed. I have the one side, let's say the front side or the back side, whichever, completed. And this is the quilting pattern we're going to do today. So I already have the piping on, of course, have my strap connectors and quilted it. And this is going to be good to go once we're ready to put it all together. I also have one of my side pieces completed with the connector and of course have that quilted as well. I have quilted the other side, but I haven't put the connector on yet, the strap connector. We're going to put that on together. And then I have completed, well, I have folded my two strap connectors for my front section here. And I edge coated the bottom here, but that's as far as I got because we're going to sew them on after we quilt. Other than that, I think that is everything that I have done. So the other main section I have ready to go. I have the foam on the back. I went ahead and used some 505 spray to put that on just to kind of hold it in place while I sew. Move all this other stuff out of the way, and I'm going to show you how to do this kind of crisscross pattern. It's straight line quilting. It is not difficult at all. The main thing sometimes is just making sure that you center the pattern onto the piece. Now you notice here I've already cut my piece out. I have not cut the piece larger, quilted it, and then cut it down, although that is an option. You can certainly do that. These pieces are so small that when you quilt them, they really don't shrink up, and they're not cotton. They don't shrink. So you don't have to really worry about the size of the piece changing drastically once you quilt it, number one. Number two, if you're using leather, which in this case I'm using faux leather, but if you were using leather, you certainly don't want to waste leather and cut a piece drastically larger than you need. As you know, once you put holes in leather or faux leather, they're there. So, you know, if you've got a large piece and you quilt the whole thing and you have some holes where the quilting comes out or whatnot, and you want to reuse that piece, I mean, it's there. It's like that. You don't have to fix it or just do something different. So just kind of keep all that in mind. But in order to get my pattern centered, what I'm going to do, first of all, is find the center of this piece. So I'm just going to do that with a mark, top, and a mark at the bottom. And this piece is a pretty large piece, easy to find the center of, but it's never going to hurt to make those marks. Now I have a ruler here, and the main thing you want to make sure of is that your ruler, and I hope this isn't throwing a lot of glare. I know these rulers are hard to see sometimes, but this has a 45 degree angle on it, and that's going to be the key to this. That and finding the center. And then of course knowing what you want your pattern to be when you start. So the pattern is a double diamond. And I say double diamond, it's just two lines. These two lines are 1/2 inch apart. These two lines are 2 inches apart, okay? So as long as you know what you want to measure, you'll be good to go. So I'm going to start by, from the bottom center, measuring up. It's about 5 inches, or excuse me, 5.5 inches is what I'm measuring up. So I'm just going to do that and make a mark with a silver marking pen. And of course, the silver marking pen is your friend when you do something like this. And you don't want to draw real hard on here. You just want to make light lines and then you can just wipe them off when you're done. Okay, so there's my center. So what I want to do from here is to place the 45 degree angle line, which happens to be right here on my ruler, on the top of the bag, right along the top. And I want my dot to be, I want to center the dot in one of these 2 inch sections, okay? So I'm going to put my dot on the 1 inch line. So I'm just going to move this down until my dot is on the 1 inch line. make sure my angle is correct, because pretty much once I do this first line, all my other lines are going to be in this direction, are going to be based off this line. Okay, so I'm just going to go ahead and draw a line all the way down, and then from that line I'm going to go up a half inch. Okay, so now I'm going to go up 2 inches. And then I'm going to go up a half inch. And these measurements are from the previous line drawn. Half inch, 2 inches, and a half inch. Okay, so there's one set. Now we're going to go in the other direction. So from this line, our first line we drew, we're going to come over 2 inches. And then from there, a half inch. And you get the point. 2 inches. Half inch, and then 2 inches is off the bag, so I won't worry about that one. Okay, so from here, all we're going to do is sew straight lines right on top of our line. Easy enough. Now, you don't have to backstitch. However, if you do, it will certainly help the stitches from starting to come undone, especially as you're working with this bag. That could certainly happen. It's a lot to tie them all off, so I am going to do just like one little tiny back stitch at the start and end of each one of these lines. I do also like to kind of start in the middle of the bag. That's just a preference, so that if the foam is not laying flat for some reason, you start in the middle and then you kind of work the foam out to the right or to the left or up and down, however it is you're quilting. Okay, so we're just going to do a couple of stitches. We're just going to keep on going. So now that all of the lines are done in one section, we still have our middle here, and we want to do exactly the same thing. From this middle dot, we're going to measure over an inch this way and up an inch that way. And we're going to line the 45 degree line up on the bottom of the bag this time. So I'm just going to move this. So that it is lined up so my dot is right here and it's right there on that 45 degree angle, or excuse me, right there on that 1 inch mark. Okay, so take your marking pen and we're going to do the same thing. We're going to do 1 inch, and we're going to do a half inch. I'm going to turn this so I can see it a little better. We're going to do 2 inches. And we're basically just going to continue to mark just like we did before. Every half inch and then every 2 inches until we're done making all of our marks. And now we're going to stitch in the other direction. So once you're done with this part, what you want to do is just wipe off your lines. Now, I usually end up using a damp cloth and just go down and wipe all of these off. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. But I am going to remember that this is my center point because that's where I want to put my bag tag. So I'm going to get all that done and then we'll come back. Everything, all my little lines are off. Of course, that makes a huge difference. And I have my bag tag on and we are ready to move on. And the next step, we are going to put our strap connectors on. So the first thing you want to do is to measure, and I give you these measurements in the pattern. You're going to measure from the short straight edge and then from here you want to go ahead and put a rectangle ring onto each strap connector. Or you can use O-rings here, it doesn't have to be a rectangle ring. You're going to take a little bit of double-sided tape or something to hold this down, which little piece here on the end. Now, even before I do that, I do want to show you a little trick. If you open these up just a little bit, and of course my double side tape's working really good, okay, and cut a slight angle, and there's no rule for this, you just want to go ahead and cut like a little triangle off each end. And then you take that edge now and bring it to the center. You are going to have these little bubbles. Just put your scissors in there and cut them out so they lay flat. Okay, put a little bit of double-sided tape on the edge. Rectangle ring on, and then you're going to remove the double-sided tape and place the edge of the connector right along that line you made. And since you created this little kind of tapered edge, when you sew this on, you're not going to see your edges peeking out on each side. I often forget to do that, but it's really a great little trick that you can do just to keep those pesky edges from, you don't have to go deep or far. Fold that in. Okay, just put my scissors wherever those little bubbles are, it doesn't matter. Try to get them to lay flatter. Put a little bit of double-sided tape. Got it sticking everywhere. Okay, we'll fold this over. All right. Now, in the pattern, I do show you how to do this. You don't have to, but what I did was I took this strap connector, took the long edges, put it to the center. You see I have a curved edge here. I just used a curved edge point or a punch to punch that curved edge out. You certainly don't have to do that. You can leave it flat or straight, or you can do a different shape. And then I went ahead and put some base coat and edge coat on that just to kind of give it a finished look. None of those things are necessary, but they do help. So we're going to take some half-inch double-sided tape and put it up over or the bottom. And I am going to just let the tape grab the edge of this folded over connector here, okay? Just to help that stay. Okay. And now from our center point, we're going to do our measurements. And the main thing you want to make sure of is that obviously your strap is straight. The good thing about quilting is you can kind of almost make sure of that in with the quilted edges. You're also going to come down from the top. And again, a measurement I give you in the pattern. You just kind of get all this lined up. Peel the backing off of your tape. Go ahead and lay this down. And I leave my ruler on there so that I can make sure my strap connector's straight. And then of course, since this is quilted, I can also see that that strap connector runs in the middle of these two diamonds. So it kind of visually helps me. If my quilting was crooked, like slightly, I would probably put these on slightly crooked just so that visually it all looks correct. You know, sometimes if you've got, something that is crooked and you try to put something straight on top of it, it makes it look more crooked, if that makes sense. So I usually just try to, once I'm done, look at it and make sure it looks okay before I start sewing. So what I want to make sure of is that both connectors are ending at about the same place, which they are, right here at the kind of peak of this diamond. They're both going through the center of a quilting here, and we're going to go ahead and quilt or stitch these on. What I am going to do is one more marking because I want to make sure I'm even. I'm going to go ahead and put a mark 1 inch down from the top of the fold, not the connector. Okay, so not the top up here, not this, just from this fold. And that's where I'm going to turn. So I'm going to come up, I'm going to go across this line I'm getting ready to make, and then I'll come down and do the little curve and just go ahead and stitch that on. I'm going to stitch it in all four sides, or on all four sides. So I'm just going to, from that, just do a little mark. Same thing on this side. From the top, make a little mark. And now I know that I'll be turning at the same point on both connectors. Okay. So the last thing I will say is I'm not going to backstitch. I'm going to pull my threads through to the front, or back rather, not the front, and tie them off. And it doesn't really matter where you start because you got to go all the way around in a circle here. So. I make sure when I start my curve, I just kind of take my time, and these are pretty sharp curves, so I'm just going to use my hand wheel. When I get up to this line, I'm going to stop and turn. Stitch across. Come down the other side. Do you want to pull this thread through to the back? I'll go ahead and tie it off. I'm going to put a little bit of double-sided tape on that, and that just helps the knot from coming apart or coming untied. Okay, my foot still had a little bit of silver marking pen on from quilting, so I can just wipe that off. And then the last mark I'm going to make is from the top of the fold. One more time, I'm going to come down a half inch. I'm going to put a dot right in the middle of the strap connector, and that's where my rivet is going to go. Okay, right there. So I'm just going to punch that hole. place the rivet. Okay, I will set that rivet and then I will proceed and do the other connector. I have both strap connectors on. I have my rivets in so they're extra secure. And we are going to now work on the piping that's going to go around this piece. So I'm going to set this piece aside for just a minute and take my piping piece. Now on the piping piece, I've already put 1/4 inch double-sided tape and I put it about a little less than a quarter, maybe about 1/8 of an inch from the edge. I also have my piping piece. Just gonna kind of straighten that out. And I'm going to peel the backing off the tape a little at a time, not all at once, and just put my piping piece 1 inch or so, maybe even, what is that? About 1.5 inches from the edge. And then I'm going to fold the piping piece or the fabric over the piping piece and stick it as best I can where it's even to the other side, and that tape will hold it down. And then I just want to kind of finger press against the piping piece. Okay, so it's kind of nice and tight. And of course, there's no piping over here. All right, so we're going to go down this piping piece and we're just going to do that all the way down, just fold it over. The ends don't have to be perfectly perfect, but you do want to have them as close as possible to matching these long edges here, okay? Because that is going to be what we're going to line up on the side of the bag. It measures the 1/2 inch, which is our 1/2 inch seam allowance, and it just all works out. So however you need to do this, sometimes it's a little difficult. The piping wants to stick to the double-sided tape. You don't want that to happen. So that's why you want to take off just a little bit of the backing on the tape, of the tape, that's backing of the tape in sections, not all at once. Getting tongue-tied. Just going to work our way down. Now that all that is completed, we're going to take the end where our piping ends. We just fold it over to right at the edge of the piping. And I'm just going to take a pair of scissors and cut a little triangle right in the seam allowance. From here, you're going to take the ends of those triangles and just let them meet. Okay. Just put a little clip. And then we're going to go to the main part of our bag and we're going to measure down 1 inch on each short edge here from the top. So 1 inch, actually it's from the long edge on the short edge. And this is where we're going to start and stop our piping. Now, as we sew this piping on, this first pass, we're not trying to get super close to the piping yet. So I'm not going to change my foot to my piping foot. I'm going to take the edge here and I'm going to line it up with that mark. And then I'm just going to go ahead and clip the piping onto the bag. And I'm matching the edges of the piping to the edge of the bag. When you get to the curve, you're going to have to make some clips because you have a curved edge and a straight edge. You always clip your straight edge. Now you don't want to clip to the piping. You just want to make little clips about halfway to the piping. And then what that will do is allow you to just go right around that curve. Those little snips that you made are going to open up. Of course, when we get to the other side, we're going to do our snips again. And then as you approach your other mark, I'm going to cut this back and open up the fabric and right where I made my mark, I want to cut my piping only. Okay, I'm going to put the piping pieces back together, fold this over again, make a little triangle, and then go ahead and fold that over at the triangle and clip it. Okay, that's not wanting to clip. There we go. Okay, so now we're going to sew this piping on. And again, I'm not going to worry about getting super close right now. I just want to get the piping on so that I can take my clips off. As you start, I'm going to relieve this. I don't want this necessarily to be at a right angle. I'm going to let it come up a little bit because I don't want to see the edges of the upper part of this triangle on the right side of my bag. Okay, I want that to stay in the seam allowance. So I'm just going to let it do kind of a little angle there. As I go around this curve, a lot of times what I'll do is take the piping and kind of just push it out amongst the edge of the curve just to make sure that it's all the way to the edge. So again, I have my piping here. I don't want it to obviously be straight. Don't want it to be so tucked in that you see that little edge on the outside of the bag. So I'm just going to kind of let it sit at an angle and come on up. And then my front panel is complete. So now I have my front panel complete. Of course, I have my back panel complete as well. These are both good to go. We have one side panel complete. So let's work on the other side panel. So I already have it quilted. I'm going to take my backing off the tape. I just marked the center of the connector and put some double-sided tape down the center. I'm just going to fold this over to the line. And when I fold the second line in, or the second side in, I want it to match the other side. You know, sometimes we leave a space when we're doing a handle because we're going to fold it again, but we're not folding this a second time. So I'm just bringing that second long edge to meet the first long edge. All right, from here, I'm going to go ahead and mark from one edge, does not matter which one. Draw a line, and then get my other D-ring, and we're going to slide that on. And before we tape it all down, I'm going to do the same little trick on this edge. Should have done it before I stuck it down, but we're just going to open this up. Little snips, bring that new edge all the way over, snip out our little humps, put our D-ring on, put some double-sided tape. And then I'm going to put double-sided tape down the back side of this connector so that we can put it on the bag. And this is just going to help hold it in place while we sew it. I am going to let that double-sided tape come slightly over the edge to help hold that turned edge over. And in this case, we're just going to center this. So I'm going to line the short edge up with the center of the one of the short edges here. And then we are going to go all the way up. I'm going to make sure that it looks like there's about the same amount of space on each side. There's not, so let me kind of fix that. Okay, and then we're going to do the same thing where we mark 1 inch from the folded edge, draw a line, and this time we're going to start from the bottom. We're going to stitch up, cross that line, and down the other side. We're gonna make one more mark, a half inch down. And centered. And then we are going to go ahead and put a ribbon. Okay, I'm going to set this rivet and then our side will be completed. Now that our side is completed, we're going to take the bottom, and I have Decaville Heavy on the bottom, and we are going to match these short edges and clip them, and then we're going to stitch. Once we're done stitching, we want the seam allowance to stay towards this bottom panel. And we're just going to top stitch on the bottom panel itself. And we're going to repeat that same process for the other side. Here we need to put our purse feet on. And I do suggest purse feet for this bag because it is a large bag. So we want to put one in the middle, and then we're going to put two on the sides. But because this is so small, the feet are going to go actually on the main part of the gusset here for the sides. Now, because I quilted this, I want to make sure that I don't cut and put a foot in somewhere along the quilt line. So I might have to adjust my measuring a little bit, you know, just to be safe and make sure I don't do that. So the first thing I'm going to do is find the center of my bottom panel by matching these seams. And then I'm just going to draw a line. And then also this way. Let's see, that is, oops, line feet. Okay, so right there where that intersecting point is where my center foot is going to go. So the side purse feet, we're going to measure from the side seams. It's going to be the second stitching line right here. Not this far one. That's our top stitching line. This line right here. Just put the ruler down. And, of course, I have a pen. But let me see if I can mark that and if it will show up. And it does. And then I want to measure 1 inch in from the side. So over here on this side, my intersecting point is not going to be over a stitch line, so that's good. And let's see over here, it is not either. So I'm okay here. Won't have to worry about breaking any of those stitches. Let me try this side. This side is gonna be close. Let's see. I'm just gonna have to be careful because I'm having to do it very, very close to the stitches. But as long as I don't cut them, I'll be okay. So I'm actually gonna put the point of my craft knife going in the other direction so I don't accidentally cut the stitches. And on this side, I'm gonna put the point in going this direction. Let's see how that does. I'm going to go ahead and put these feet in, and then we will continue on. The feet are installed, so now we get to put the exterior together. So I have marked the center of my gusset panel, and I had already marked the center of my bag. So I'm just going to match those center points. Clip. Basically put clips all on the bottom here. Okay, so now again we have a curve and we have a straight line. So you're going to snip the straight line, and we want to snip it so that it will curve in to the seam here, and the upper corner is going to match the upper corner of our bag. So I'm going to clip that first. Turn this over so I can see. And this is the pass that we want to make sure we get super close to our piping, because this will be the final pass. So I will put a piping foot on. Okay, I'm going to show you this corner. So see how that doesn't really fit very well? I mean, if I smooshed it up, it would be okay. But you really want this to lay flat. So I'm going to put, it doesn't need many, as you can see, it fits pretty well. But I am going to put a couple of snips in the gusset. Just to help that lay flat. So when that happens, you will see the snips open up. See how those little triangles open up? And it allows it to lay flat. So we're going to do the same thing over here. Go ahead and clip. And then again, it's not really laying flat there. You can see how it wants to stick up some. So we're just going to do a few snips. I'm just gonna make sure I don't snip my stitches, my quilting stitches. So I'm gonna go ahead and switch my foot out, put my cording foot on, and then we'll go ahead and stitch this on. I have my cording foot on. I'm gonna go ahead and start up here at the top. And of course, the first few inches don't have any cording. Or the first inch, really. Come up on my cording. I'm just going to make sure that the foot rests on that cording piece. Basically, the cording foot has a divot in it, like a little valley that the piping fits into. And if there's a spot where you're not going, where you may have problems and not get close enough, it's going to be right here in this curve. Just sew it the first time, and if you need to go back and sew it again, you can do that. You don't have to take it apart. You just need to sew closer. So we're going to see how we do. I'm just gonna take my time around these curves, turn, stop. If I have to shift the gusset, I will. So I'm going to check this out and just make sure the piping looks good everywhere. The main thing I want to see is, you know, that make sure that I don't see any of my stitches. My corners look great. Check this one. And that looks really good. If you didn't get close enough, again, just go ahead and don't take it apart. Just restitch it and just stitch it a little bit closer to your piping. Okay. So I'm going to repeat the same process on the other side. Go ahead and clip this on. I will stitch around and then we'll be able to turn our bag. I have that last side sewn. I'm going to just cut off my little extra pieces of piping here. Of course, there's no piping in there. It's just the fabric. Okay, I am not going to, let's see, most of our corners are already clipped, right? Because we went in there and as we did the curves, remember we had to cut the straight edges. The only thing that's not clipped is the main part of the bag that's already curved. I'm gonna throw a few clips in here. I'm not going to cut the seam back because a lot of times in this situation, the seam, this extra little bit will take up behind the piping and it fills it in and it actually makes it look nice. So we're gonna test that out before I start cutting seam back, seam allowances back, and see if that is the case here. And if it is, then we will be good to go. But let's see, let's just cut this. All right, should be enough. So let's go ahead and turn the bag. Look at that. Came out great. Okay, looks really good. All right, so I'm going to put this aside and we are going to work on the zipper placket. So go ahead and take your lining pieces for your zipper placket and your two main pieces. Now, usually I recommend using waterproof canvas for this. I am actually using a linen this time. You don't have to use waterproof canvas, but because it is a bag that holds a water bottle that could possibly leak, you know, it's usually a good idea. This bag is actually going to a show, and so I really want to use some regular linen in it. So that's what I'm doing. I'm going to put some half-inch double-sided tape along the short edges. Well, maybe. There we go. Do it on the main part and the lining part. Now, zipper plackets are one of those things that you need a little practice with them. The main thing for me that I had to learn was where my machine wanted to catch the fabric, I guess you could say, or where it, like the humps, some of the humps, it wanted to make uneven stitches, and I always thought my zipper pockets kind of looked bad. So what I did is over time, just learned where those points were, and I either hand crank over those areas or just do whatever it is that I need to do to make sure that doesn't happen. And again, that just comes with practice. It comes with knowing your machine and just keep at it and they will improve with time, I promise. So on one of these, I am going to fold the short edges over a half inch. On the other main piece, I'm going to fold one edge over the half inch. On both lining pieces, I'm going to fold one edge over, maybe. Okay. So now that we have those completed, we're going to take our zipper, and you can do a couple things. You can fold it, just use your eye to fold it in, or you can make a mark across it. You just want to make sure that the line is even, and that's where we're going to fold the zipper. So undo it just a little bit, fold right on that line that you made, and then take that folded edge and put it up against the zipper teeth. Hold that in place, and we do the same thing. Go ahead and pinch on that line, and that's what it does, is the line gives you the ability to make sure that these are folded at the same edge and are straight across. And if they're not, just adjust them. So you want this edge right here to be straight across. And with the zipper tape going towards the back, we are just going to base this in place. I'm going to go ahead and change my foot back to my regular foot, and then we'll do that. With the teeth facing towards the back, we're just going to do a little stitch here. Just make sure you do not run over your, or hit your pin as you stitch. And I am probably just about out of bobbin with all that quilting I did. Stitch this and then we'll check it out. From here, on the main piece that we folded both edges over on, we're going to put double-sided tape on one of those long edges. And I'm using 1/8 inch here. And then we're going to take the zipper and place the right angle that we created here with the zipper teeth right about where the end of our fold is, kind of like in the middle of where the fold is in the top. Okay, because we folded that over 1/2 inch. We want our zipper teeth to be about 1/4 inch from the edge. Okay, so you can kind of see there where that is, just overlapping. You don't want to put it all the way to the edge. And if you put it right where the fold is, if you put the teeth right where the fold is, it becomes super bulky. So just a little before that, and then I'm just going to take this zipper and lay it down. I'm not pulling the zipper. I'm just laying it down. I'm going to take one of my lining pieces, put double-sided tape from the folded edge on one of the long edges all the way to about 1 inch away from the other side. Peel the backing off the tape, and the folded edge we want to place up against one of the folded edges of the main placket piece. Okay, then we're just going to lay the lining down right along the edge of the zipper tape. And then when we get to the other side, we're going to peel the backing off the tape. And we're going to fold that edge up to the edge of our main fabric. Okay. If it's more than 1/2 inch, fine. If it's less than 1/2 inch, fine. We just want to make sure that this is even here across. So now both edges are even. With the zipper teeth facing down against your machine bed, you want to stitch 1/4 inch, just straight down this line, and sew this zipper on. I'm going to try it with the bobbin and we'll see what happens. I think I'm about out. From here, we're going to fold the wrong sides of this zipper placket together. And clip. Okay, and just leave this as is for right now. We're going to take our double-sided tape, put it along one of the long edges on the other side of our zipper placket main piece. Leave it about an inch from the short edge. Peel the backing off that tape. Place the folded edge on the other side of your zipper teeth. Again, you want to be about a quarter of an inch, but more importantly is you want to be even with your other main piece here, okay? So if this ends up being a little more than a quarter of an inch, that's fine. A little less, no problem. Just you want to make sure that those are even. That's the most important thing at this point. Then we're going to lay the rest of the zipper down. Again, don't pull. Well, let's see if I can get it down right. All right, and then we're going to repeat that same process for this last piece of lining. Match it up. We're matching it up with the main piece and also our other side. I'm just going to lay this down. And I forgot to fold my main fabric up. Let me take my main fabric placket piece up and fold it even with the other side. Okay, so I'm nice and even here, and then I'm going to turn this over and do the same thing on the lining. All right, so now we're going to stitch. Ran out of bobbin. Look at that. Perfect timing. Cut this off. I don't think I did that on the other one. Check it. Get that bulk out of there. Nope. Let me cut that back. Okay, so now we're going to top stitch. And what we're going to do is we're going to top stitch this closed, the short side. We're going to top stitch along the zipper's edge, top stitch this closed, and then baste that side. And then we're going to repeat that on this other side after we place our bobbin. If you're going to quilt this bag, you're definitely going to need probably 3, maybe 4 bobbins, depending on what kind of quilt design you do too. All right, make any final adjustments you need. And right here, this is a lot of bulk, okay? This is one of those places that my machine, even a dusting machine, doesn't love. So a lot of times if I'm gonna do any kind of hand stitching or hand rolling of my wheel, it's gonna be in this section. Because as you see, my foot is way far up in the air. And if their foot is going to drag, it's going to be here as well. So I'm going to take an extra piece of faux and just roll it up, make myself a little hump jumper to stick underneath there with that extra lip of it right here going underneath my foot to protect my faux. And I even, despite that, I'm going to go ahead and take a hand stitch, another hand stitch, adjust my hump jumper, maybe one more hand stitch, and then I'll start sewing. This is another point here that it could get real thick. And of course you have your other piece of siding over here to deal with. So I'm just gonna kind of fold this in half and then do a couple of hand stitches, get past it. And then go ahead and baste this side closed. Okay, I'm going to repeat that process on the other side. We have the zip-up placket completed. We're just going to tear this apart, set it aside, and we'll move on. We are going to work on getting this lining put together. So I give you a measurement in the pattern. You're going to flip the longest piece wrong side down, and from the left side, you're going to measure over and draw a line. From there, you're going to draw a half inch line in either direction, because that's going to be where we start our stitching. Okay. From there, you're going to turn this over, and then from the right side, you're going to do another measurement, and I'm going to do this with a fabric erasing pen. And let me just say that your sides are slightly angled, so when you take your ruler to line this up, you want to line your ruler up with the top edge. That's the straight edge. So I am just going to do that and draw a line. Okay, so that's on the long piece. So now we have, your lines should be on the same side. Okay, I have one line here and I have one line over here on this right side. So then you're going to take your smaller piece, and with the right side up, we're going to make a measurement from the left-hand side, so this side. So I'm going to put this ruler back on. Again, line it up at the top. And then I'm just going to draw a line. Okay, from here, we're going to take our one section, put them right sides together with the other, and the seam where we want to line up is the back of this one with the front of this one. So this is your longer piece. The line you drew on the back is going to get lined up with the line you drew on the front of the smaller piece. We're just going to line those up. Make sure they're lined up at the bottom. And then we are going to stitch from our intersecting point to our intersecting point down here. You do want to back stitch just a little bit. From here, take the long piece and put the wrong sides together, and you're going to take the right piece and put the wrong sides together. So they're separated by the seam. Okay, this is what you have. And where you drew the line on the right side of your fabric, you're going to make a small snip a half inch in, and that's basically the same half inch that you sewed down here. So if you need to make a little mark to make sure you know where that half inch is, you can certainly do that. And when we cut, we're cutting through both pieces, okay? Both this front top piece and the bottom piece. And we're just going to cut up to that little line we made. All right, and we're going to open this up. Go ahead and open it up all the way. And we're going to put just a little bit of double-sided tape on the edge here between our two snips. Do it at the top and the bottom. And then go ahead and peel the backing off the tape and fold this up to your snip. So in the middle, you're going to have the seam as your guide, and then on each side, you're going to have your little snip as the guide. Okay. So we are going to separate these one more time. And now you want to stitch down your line that you made on the right side of this longer piece and across the bottom to close the bottom. Don't stitch the top closed yet. So of course the bottom is the part with the curved edge. So now when you remove your clip, you will see that you have the beginnings of the lining with the divider built in. Okay? Kind of neat how that comes together. So we're going to take and lay this lining down. We're going to make sure that the divider and this top section are all going in one direction. And essentially this is our part of our bag that we're going to be using as a purse. So we're going to find the center by just putting a mark here. So take your edge, your raw edge on the right hand side, bring it to your seam, and that will be the center. Okay, and we're going to put our slip pocket on this side. So of course I give you some measurements to use in the pattern as far as where to put it. I do want to center it, so let me just do a little. And I'm going to use the SewTight magnets to hold this in place. There is a link down below for you to purchase these if you are interested. They work wonderful. And because this is such a large pocket, I am going to divide it in two. So right there down the center, I'm just going to draw a line. So I'm going to stitch down over and down, over, and then back up. Okay, there we have our pocket on. So I'm gonna go ahead and put rivets here in these corners. I like to do that on my slip pockets just to kind of give it a little extra stability. And whenever I do that, I'm always going to put a little bit of Decaville Heavy or something to stabilize the back. So here on the back, I'm just going to take, I always have little pieces of Decaville that I keep when I cut it, you know, just keep little squares for this reason. Slide that on. Okay, I'll set these rivets and then we will return and put the zipper pocket in on the other side. So here the rivets are set. I'm just gonna take this upper piece of fabric, turn it to the other side. Actually, what I'm gonna do is take this lower piece here and just get it out of the way. Let's do that, it'll be easier. So you've got basically the section here, this little water bottle section that was going in this direction. We're just gonna lift it up and put it in the other direction. And now we're dealing with this side of the lining. So we're gonna find the center just like we did on the other side, and we're gonna put our zipper pocket centered over here. You just wanna make sure everything's out of the way. We're going to go ahead and peel the backing off the tape that we have our zipper overlay on. Find the center and then go ahead and put this on the back. Let me get a different ruler. Okay, so from here we're going to sew around the outside rectangle. Pull the threads through to the back so I can tie them off. And just make sure I start and stop in the same hole. Once that's tied, I like to put just a little piece of double-sided tape over it. Just to kind of make sure that knot does not come apart. And then making sure, again, everything's out of the way, we are going to cut the center of this out. Okay, as I mentioned in the beginning of the video, I have my zipper pocket completed, so I'm just going to pull backing off the tape. And we're going to center this zipper pocket right in that opening. And you want to center this not only right to left, but up and down. And my zipper pull is going in this direction. I wanted it to go in the other direction, so I'm going to turn that around. Try that again. Let's see. So now we're going to stitch around the smaller rectangle. Make sure your zipper pocket stays open when you do this. And since we do not want double-sided tape hanging out inside our pocket, I will just singe the edges of the threads with a lighter. Okay, so from here, we are going to take this upper pocket and fold it down to the lower pocket. Whenever you use this method to put pockets in, you're always going to have about an inch to an inch and a quarter of extra pocket here at the bottom. I'm just going to cut that off. And because of the divider, this is a drop-in lining. So we're going to close the bottom of this pocket as we sew it. There's no need to leave that open. So I'm going to turn this so that it's right side up and then take and just pull the lining side, and we're going to stitch down, then over the bottom, or you know, along the bottom, and then back up the other side. And there we have our zipper pocket completed. And of course our slip pocket on the other side. As we sew all of this together, you'll see this is going to be the opening for our purse stuff, and this will be the opening over here for our water bottle. Before we put our upper lining on, we need to go ahead and put our zipper plackets on. I always like to start with the same side as the zipper pull for the zipper pocket, because I want to make sure my zippers are going in the same direction. So since my zipper is closing in this direction, I'm going to make sure that the zipper is closing in this direction here. You want to put the, I've got the wrong section, I'm going to put it this way. You're going to put this right at the top, but we're not centering it. It's a little different than normal. We want to put it against this divider. Okay, and that should give you about a half inch on this side to sew the gusset on. And you can cheat it a little bit if you think that this is a little more than a half inch. Looks like mine might be. So I'm just going to leave a little bit of space. I have about an eighth of an inch over here where the divider is. Basically what we want to do is make sure that when we close this, we don't want a big space necessarily here by where the divider is. We want this pretty close. So we're going to baste this on. And then from here, you want to take your upper lining. Now the upper lining, clip this out of the way. You gotta pretend that this piece right here isn't even here. This is the section we're working with. Your upper lining has got one side that's a little shorter than the other. The shorter side goes against the lower lining. You can see how that fits right there. So line that up and then just flip it over and then go ahead and clip it. Now, when you get to your divider, you obviously want to make sure that that divider is out of the way. Since it's a half inch shorter than the upper lining, you should be able to just go ahead and clip the upper lining without catching the divider. And then we're going to stitch. Now, as we stitch, we're going to come on down. Once we hit the point where the divider is, we're just going to lift this up, push this whole section over, and then continue stitching. So I'm approaching right here where my divider is. I'm just going to lift this up, turn this to the other side, lay it down, and then continue stitching. So from here, you're going to leave your seam allowance going up towards your upper lining, and you're just going to fold that upper lining over, and we're going to top stitch. And see, now your divider is out of the way. Matt, this part of top stitching should be easy. Nothing's in the way there. You don't have to worry about the divider. So now we have the upper lining on this side of the lining. We're going to go ahead and I'm going to repeat the same thing for the other side. I'm going to move all this over, put the zipper placket on, and then put the upper lining on, and then we'll continue. So here we have both of our upper linings on, and the main part of the lining is completed. We're going to put our gusset together, which is just a matter of stitching these upper lining pieces on. These pieces, just like the upper lining on the main part of the bag, have a shorter section, and that's going to go against your smaller side here. So we're going to line those up and stitch. We're going to leave the upper lining going towards the, or the seam allowance going towards the upper lining, and we're going to top stitch. Okay, let's find the center of our gusset. And then we're also going to find the center of our main lining pieces. Now, you've got two lining pieces that are connected right now with a center divider. This is one side, right? Okay, you've got the divider attached, but essentially this is one lining piece. We don't want to find the center of this section. We want to find the center of the whole piece. So I'm going to match these curved edges because the gusset's going over the whole lining. And I'm going to put a little notch. I'm going to turn this around and I'm going to do the same thing. Match my corners, and then from here, just put a little notch. Okay, so it looks like it's off center when you're looking at just this section, but you got to keep in mind it's the entire piece here, and that's the center. All right, the last thing we want to do before we put this gusset on is we need to go ahead and put a little bit of stabilizer in this divider piece and top stitch it. So let me get that piece and we'll do that. Okay, so I have my stabilizer. This is just Decoville Light. I will say that I did try Decoville Heavy here and it was too much, so just kind of keep that in mind. If you want a super stable divider, you could certainly try it, but I preferred the Decoville Light during my testing. So I'm just gonna stick that in there. Should slide down. And of course you shouldn't be able to see it. And then we're just gonna top stitch this divider piece closed. Of course, make sure everything's out from underneath it. You don't want to accidentally stitch your lining to it. So now we have the divider in there, good to go. So now let's go ahead and clip our gusset. I'm going to clip it to one side first. So match up your centers. I'm going to clip down, and then I'm going to turn and match up the side. Now you want your upper lining to match. You want to make sure that lines up, and then we're going to start our stitching there so that we can ensure that is good and matched up. So of course, as you go to attach this lining, you're going to have to make small snips in the gusset. The gusset is the straight piece in order to make that fit. So I'm just going to do little snips. And there's no rhyme or reason or rule or anything when it comes to these snips. Just don't make them too deep. That would be the only rule. And then once you snip them, you should be able to just go ahead and push that in the corner and it should fit nicely. Put a few clips. Now, the other side of this is on the other side of this divider. So we're going to have to kind of move the divider out of the way. Go ahead and clip around the divider. We're going to clip the upper linings, making sure that matches. And then, of course, we're going to have to snip our gusset again. So I make my little clips, pull that into the corner. So here's the other side. We're just going to kind of make sure all that's in the middle here. We're going to, with the gusset up, go ahead and stitch around and stitch this gusset in place. Go ahead and shift your corners as you go to make sure that you don't have any tucks. Because your divider is shorter by a half inch, you should be able to stitch right past it without any problems. I'm going to trim the seam allowance slightly. Do not trim it at your upper linings, because when you open this up, you want to make sure you have enough seam allowance to open that up so it lays nice and flat. So I'm just going to come in right below the upper lining and just do a little snip here. Okay, so now we have our gusset on one side of our lining. Okay, so all we're going to do is lay this lining right on top of it. We're going to match our centers just like we did before, match our sides, go ahead and clip our
gusset and sew this other side on. So I'm gonna go ahead and do that and then we'll continue, put the bag together. I have the lining completed and don't forget to slide your key fob into that last piece that you stitch. And this is what we have. Looks great. So this is a drop-in lining, as I mentioned before. I want to go ahead and fold the edge over. So I'm gonna use, and I'm gonna use my Decaville as a guide for that. But I'm gonna use some double-sided tape as well to hold that down. Now, if your machine does not like double-sided tape, you can certainly just clip this. But I find the double-sided tape kind of helps everything stay in place, and then you don't have to worry about coming apart. So I'm gonna open up those seam allowances and just stick this at the edge of the bag. I'm gonna go all the way around. And before you actually fold this over and do all of the double-sided tape, you probably want to just do a dry fit, like a test run, to make sure that the lining fits inside well and you're not having to increase any of your seams. Just kind of make sure everything is okay, because once you get this double-sided tape on and you fold this over, it's not impossible to undo, but it's not fun. Okay, so from here, I'm just gonna peel the backing off this tape and again, use the stabilizer as the edge to peel that, or to fold that right over. And of course, on your seams, you're gonna wanna make sure those are open to put that down. And by using the stabilizer, it gives it a nice crisp edge. All right, we're gonna set that aside and we're gonna take our main part of our bag. We're gonna do the same thing. And of course, since I have quilted this, I actually have foam that I'm folding over instead of Decaville Light. Make sure the seam allowances are open. Just put it right on the edge. So now that we have the both edges folded over, I am going to put the lining inside. Now, presumably the front of your bag is where your tag is. You need to think about how you'll be holding this bag, typically on your right shoulder, your left shoulder. Do you want the divider, the water bottle, to be in the front of you or in the back of you? So just kind of keep that in mind as you put this lining in. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and make sure it's pressed down really well. And then I'm going to clip the top edge, and then we're going to go over to the cylinder arm and stitch this together. So you just want to make sure, of course, that the edges meet up really nice. You want to make sure that your seams match up. And I am actually going to put a little bit of double-sided tape, not on the edge where I'm sewing, because there are two layers, but down a little further to help hold this together so it doesn't slip as I sew. So I'm going to get all that done and then meet you at the cylinder arm and we will sew it together. I have the bag totally clipped. You can see here these clips. I got them all the way around. Even though I have tape, I'm also using clips. And I am going to go ahead and top stitch these together here at the cylinder arm. Now, it doesn't really matter where I start, but what I don't want to do is start at the front, right? So I'm just going to take this back seam, start there, and then stitch along the back. And this will be the last bit of stitching we have to do. Okay, so let's go ahead and start in. Just take it nice and slow. And obviously a cylinder arm helps. The bag's big enough you can do it on a flatbed. But being a drop-in lining usually are easier on cylinder arm machines. Thank you.
Okay, we have this top stitching done. We're going to go back to the flatbed machine and go ahead and put our finishing touches on, which is going to be our zipper end, our handles, and our crossbody strap. Here we have the completed bag for the most part. We have a few things that we had to finish up. So on the top, I put my zipper pull on, and then I went ahead and put my zipper end on as well. On the handles, I decided that because it is a larger bag, to put two rivets on each handle. So I went ahead and measured for that accordingly. And I'll tell you, a lot of times the way you do it is you take the, and I think I give you measurements for this in the pattern, but you can just take the handle, put it on the attachment here, fold it up, you know, make a mark, cut your holes, then make the other two dots. Okay. Use as many or as little rivets as you want here. That's totally up to you. So once I got one handle done, my handles are exactly the same size. So I laid one handle on top of the other handle and marked the holes for the second handle. I'm going to go ahead and put this handle on with the rivets, set the rivets. Of course, we'll connect our crossbody strap and then we will be totally done. We'll take a look at the bag. Okay, we have the bag completed, the Leah, with an amazing quilted design. It was really a great bag to do, very fun. Of course, it's very adaptable, that we talked about in the beginning of the video. Has a great crossbody strap, nice handles, use double rivets on those because it is a larger bag. Of course, we've got our zipper section, our great water bottle section, and then on the inside we have our slip pocket and our zipper pocket. So for this week, you can get a discount on this pattern. The coupon code is below. This is just another video of our oldie but goodie section. We love these old ones and we certainly don't want you to forget about them and just want to keep them fresh in your mind. So until next time, everybody, happy sewing.